So a couple of months back, I reviewed this. This is the Civiltop Air, also known as the T-Book Air. Now, it's not a bad little 12.5-inch Apollo-like laptop. It's got a decent keyboard on it. It's super light and portable. This thing weighs about 1.8 or 1.08, sorry, kilos. So really light, very thin as you can see. But it's got one major con for me. Even though I love the performance of this, it's the fastest I have actually tested yet out of the Apollo lights because it's got really fast RAM on it. The big con is this. All you have is just a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack on there and then a Type-C port. So not really that great. Now I've been using this, docking it to my monitor here, my TV, sorry, that I've got here in the studio and then my monitor at home. And it's been good using it like that. But when I'm out and about and I wanted to access, of course, say a micro SD card to have a look at some drone footage, go to plug it in, and realize I left the adapter at home for the Type-C port. So that's a bit of an annoyance. But this is where the Onda Shoma 21 comes in. It's basically this exact model. I believe it's the same ODM that has manufactured it for Onda. Of course, they're leasing it and putting their brand on it. But we've got two times USB 3 ports on there, micro SD card, and a micro HDMI out. It still has Type-C on there, but only for charging and data. So you can't get any video out of it, apparently. So let's see if this one is going to be the improved version of the T-Book Air, and hopefully the performance is going to be just as good as this one. So this one I picked up from geekbuying.com. Seems to be reasonably wrapped. Hopefully there is no damage. And it's going to be in that champagne gold color again, which I'm not particularly fond of. They seem to love it in China for some reason. So put the notebook aside for a second. We've got a user manual here that is all in Chinese. And in the left compartment here is our Type-C charger. Now this is rated to 12 volts, 3 amps, so should charge it nice and quick. So before I get started, we'll just weigh it again to see how much it weighs. So it is 1.09 grams, so it's about 10 grams or so heavier than the T-Book Air. All right, so it looks just like the other model, of course. I'd expected this because it really is the same. Pressing down on the lid there is hardly any flex, a little bit, but it's quite rigid, it's quite solid, all made out of metal. And on the bottom, you can see Onda markings on there, Shoma 21 and 4 rubber feet. Now you see here is an access slot here, which is really good. So undo this one screw, you don't have to remove the whole rear back like you have to on the T-Book Air that I've got. This will give you access to the SSD slot. On the right side, Onda did the sensible thing and they decided to put the Type-C port, micro HDMI, and a full-sized USB 3 port here on the right side, which is great because on the T-Book, you can see on the right here, you've only got the 3.5 mm headphone jack. And on the right side, yes, you noticed, where's the 3.5 mm headphone jack? It's missing. Why do they always have to do that and always have something missing from these laptops? So full-size USB 3 port and then a micro SD card slot, which is great to see. I will have to find out if I can use a Type-C to 3.5 mm adapter, if that will work and let us listen to audio. Okay, so it cannot be opened up one-handed. And the screen is an anti-glare coated one, so that is good to see. I mean, it's the same actually on the T-Book Air. If you remove the glossy screen protector that comes with pre-applied out of the factory, then you'll have the anti-glare screen, matte coated, of course. Now the touchpad is identical in size, however the fingerprint reader, hopefully it's going to be working, is now located on the right side, and the keyboard layout is the same, but I can see they've got different shortcuts. So they've decided to have function then F12 for print screen, and there's no controls there for the screen brightness this time, at least not on this model, but on the T-Book Air you'll see it is. Two microphones up the top, status LEDs, and a dedicated power on button, and the delete key is here. So that's actually a good move. You can see the difference. I do like that they've put the power button up there. Here's the Civiltop, and you can see there we get dedicated brightness controls without having to use function keys or anything like that, and a dedicated print screen button. However, the power button difference that you can see. So there we have the power button, which you could easily hit, and now that's now the delete. So hopefully that's going to be good. Now this keyboard is very firm. There's literally no flex on that. Really good keyboard. I do like it. I've been typing it on a bit. It's not bad at all. One of the better ones you'll find on a Chinese laptop. Now the bezel around the outside is quite slim on the left and right. It's made out of metal, and the front-facing webcam is 2 megapixels, but it only records in VGA if it's exactly like the Civiltop Airs. Now one thing to notice is that the microphone location, I believe, is in a better place on the earlier model, on the Civiltop, as you see here. Those microphones are located either side, so you don't get that noise of the keyboard as much. Okay, so it has an account already created. And the screen brightness, I think, and hopefully this isn't at 100%. No, it's 50%. It looks quite good. And that is 100 there, which is bright enough to me. And zero, very dim, so that's going to be great for nighttime use. Of course, the keyboard is not backlit. Not in this price range. So let's have a look at the device manager. Hopefully there's no issues with the fingerprint reader on this model. Okay, so that took a little while to load in, but not too bad. So network adapters, this should be the typical Intel dual band wireless AC3165, which it is. We see that on all the other models. Quite a good chipset, performs quite well. And our disk drive is an eMMC. So this is a Toshiba 064G30. Of course, later on in the video, I will show you the SD slot. So I'll open that up and you can install an SSD if you want better performance and more storage space. And our fingerprint reader is an Eland one. It's the WBF fingerprint sensor, and it has no problems. It seems to me like it's going to be working just fine. Okay, so time to test out the ports on the right-hand side. So the Type-C port with an adapter here. This is an adapter that goes Type-C to 3.5 millimeters. That works, and it gives us audio. Now, will it power an external hard drive? No, it actually thinks I plugged in an audio device. No power whatsoever to my hard drive. No light has come on. So that means that it's only handling charging and audio. That's it. That's all that port does. And have a look and see if the USB 3 port on the right-hand side will power an external hard drive. Blue light. And yes, it's going to handle that, which is great. I can see here that the micro SD cards protrude a little bit, approximately 1.5 millimeters, so they stick out. So in a backpack or in a case, you might be able to accidentally knock that and have it click out, but it should be okay. It's quite stiff and firm, the click and the feel to that, so it should hold that in place. Let's have a look now and see if that USB 3 port is going to access hard drives. Oh. Okay, white light means USB 2, so that's actually a USB 2 port, this port right here, and not USB 3. Okay, so a quick little typing test on the keyboard, and it's really the same kind of experience as the Civiltop Airs keyboard. So it's quite firm, good travel on the keys. I do like the keyboard, but I'm going to say that I like this one better because it has the delete key in the right place here and not the power. They moved the power up there, which is a very wise choice and a really good move from Onda. Now the memory is running at the fastest supported speed, which is 1600 megahertz, and they've reserved a little bit there for the GPU. So you've only got around 3.8 or something gigabytes when you first boot it up. Well, you're not gonna have that free, of course, because Windows eats into a little bit of that. So the free at the moment I've got is 2.5 gigabytes. All right, so on to our audio test here. The typical tests I do, a track from Carbon-based Lifeforms, who normally don't give me any copyright issues. So these speakers are internal, just like the other model, the T-Book Air. Alright, so the volume's okay, but it's got no bass really, mostly treble and mids, and a little bit of distortion coming from the housing because it's transmitting the sound through the keyboard. Now, I had a quick look inside the BIOS here. It's fully unlocked to us, so we've got full control, and I recommend not messing with any of the settings. So just here, I had a look at the Northbridge under the memory information, and it does report that they have used 4 1-gigabyte low power double data rate 3 chips. So it's going to be in dual channel. So we should see the same high performance, just like the T-Book Air, which is a really good thing here. Now under boot here, I'm going to try and boot over now into Linux. I'm just going to change the boot order. Actually, I think I can jump straight to it, and we'll see how Manjaro performs. So here we are. This is Linux Manjaro build 17 running off my USB pen drive in the USB 3 port. Touchpad works, wireless works. The battery is being detected there. Brightness controls also work on the display. You can see there, tweaking it down or up. And last check is the audio, which also works. So everything's working there, but bear in mind it's running off the pen drive. It's not fully installed onto the eMMC or the SSD. Okay, so just like the Civil Top Air, the camera is rubbish. It's 480p only. So square, not even 16:9 to match the display. And 30 frames per second is what Windows can record there, but the viewfinder is really quite choppy. Seems only about 15 frames per second to me. So you wouldn't be buying this laptop here for its webcam performance. You'd probably want to use an external Logitech one to get better quality. So here are the eMMC speeds that Toshiba drive. It's not the fastest, as you can see there, with the sequential read of 150 and then writes of 104. I mean, it's not too bad, but it's not as fast as those eMMC 5-spec ones. So you probably want to go and install an SSD like this one here I have, which is a Transcend. And I'll show you how to do that in just a second. But there's two other things I wanted to point out that I know people will be interested in. And that is HW info here. So the battery, it's reporting the capacity as 47 watt hours, which I don't believe it is. But we'll find out later on when I do my full tests and just use this for a week or so to get my battery life figures. I'll let you know more about that in the full review, of course. Now the wear level there is reporting 5.1%. Now this could be an error, but I doubt it's going to be worn to 5.1% out of the box. If it is, then that's bad, but really, I don't think it is. And the monitor is a Qimi. It's the model CMN1239, which I believe is, I could actually be wrong on this, but I could think it could be the same screen used in the Mi Notebook Air. So in order to install your own SSD, you just need to buy a SATA 3 22x42 one. Undo this screw, you can see I'm doing on the bottom. So screw that out. And then you'll just have to somehow get this out. I think it'll flick up. There we go, that comes out. And you can see that's all we have room for. There's one more screw that needs to be removed, this one here. So take that out and then slot in, screw down your SATA 3 SSD. Then the last step is to go into the BIOS, of course, and set that as the boot device. Clone or copy or do a fresh install of Windows 10 and you're done. This will increase the performance and of course your storage. But really great to see them putting these little slots on here. However, I wish they had room to put in, I can see on this device, they wouldn't have had room to put the 22x80 in, but they somehow managed to squeeze it into the Civil Top Air. But if they had that, it would be a lot better, and then we can install faster SATA 3 drives. And why not, here is a quick look at the internal. So very large battery cell that looks to me like it's made up of two cells there. And we do have an internal metal frame. Well, this is plastic here that everything is screwed into. That is glued in place with the top metal palm rest and the keyboard area. And this is the internal support metal backing that is behind the keyboard. Those are the two loudspeakers, which actually are located up on the top there. So the sound will be coming out through there. So not through the keyboard as I thought at first. And we've got a large metal heatsink here, which is great. That's good news. That should stop this from having any thermal throttling. That is the Intel Wireless 3165 dual band AC chip. Dual antennas, those antenna cables go up into the screen area. So hopefully good range and reception on that. I will check that out later, but so far seems good. Now, when it comes to the SSD slot, you probably could get a Dremel, cut this plastic down, and you would be able to fit, I would say, by just looking at it, at least the 22x60 in there if you wanted to, of course, mess things up a little bit by cutting that out, and then you'd probably just have to tape it in place. But overall, the internals look really good to me, and not bad here considering this is an Onda. Okay, so there we have it. The Shoma 21 is shaping up to be a good laptop. Now, there's a few compromises, of course, that you're going to need to find one of these, a 3.5mm to Type-C adapter, which is a bit of a pain. I wish they'd put that port on there. Now, I can clearly see they've made some compromises. They didn't have space in there, so they made a choice to go, look, what do we want? Do we want to lose the micro HDMI out, or we put a 3.5mm headphone jack? I kind of think they've made the right choice, but even so, really would like to have that 3.5mm jack on there. And why have they not included one of these $2-3 US parts in the box? Really beats me. So the left USB 3 port is in fact a USB 2 port, or it's not full, working at full speeds there. And the micro SD card slot, yes, sticks out a little bit, but that's very minor complaint there. It's great to have that SSD slot on the bottom. So very easy access, just one screw, then another screw. So two screws in total to put your SATA 3 SSD in there. It's just a shame that it's not the full size 22x80 that we have, of course, on the Civil Top Air here. Keyboard is great to type on. It's the same as this one. I prefer this keyboard because they've done, I feel, a better design choice of moving the power button right up to the top there. It means that if you go for the delete key right in the corner there, you're not going to accidentally tap the power button, which sometimes happens, although me personally, I find I don't do that on this one. Now, this model, when I got it out of the box, the fingerprint reader does not work, and I still cannot fix it. This works. Windows 10 activates this here. Windows 10 is using a temporary license, and you need to supply your own. So that's a bit of a con there. But I do like the full Type-C port it has on here, because I use this, which is a Type-C dock, and when I connect that up, and I've got my monitor and everything else connected, it's very easy for me to use a mouse. It's just one port bang in there. But with this, of course, to connect this up to a PC to use it as a desktop to connect up to a monitor, then I need to plug in my mouse, the HDMI cable, and then the Type-C port in there to charge. So I prefer when you've just got this port here. But overall, nice machine. Of course, it's so thin, it's super light. It weighs 1.09 kilos. Super light, really good screen on it too. It's a great 1080p IPS. The brightness isn't super bright, but it's efficient enough really because it's got that anti-glare coating on it. Now you see that here, the screen is glossy. Of course, as mentioned, that this one's got a screen protector on it. So pull that screen protector off and it's the same exact panel underneath. Now gaming performance, battery life, and further benchmarks will all be coming in my up and coming full review. But I can say straight away that the battery life will be better on this because I can see it does have a physically larger battery inside when we looked at the internals. Thermals on this, I don't believe are going to be a problem because there is a decent copper heatsink in there, just like this model here. So if you were going to choose between both of these, clearly I would go for this one because the fingerprint reader works, but I don't know if it's going to have the same performance as this model, the Civil Top Air, which is the fastest Apollo Lake so far. So hopefully I will see you back with the full review of this model. Thank you so much for watching. Bye for now.